Aloha and welcome to Naleo TV. My name is Zach Royer and I'm here at Palamanui campus for Earth Day 2016 celebration. Today we are going to be talking about sustainable practices here on the island, Mauka to Makai. And we have a nice list of speakers that you'll enjoy. So please stay tuned and enjoy the show.
Perhaps I just begin with a brief introduction. My name is Kalani Flores. I'm a faculty member here in the Wildlife Styles program. And of course, Ed Marty is our director.
Thank you.
Of course, you have Kihalani, who is a Kamaaina to this space, and one of us is here. But so a request is just to have a little opening for today's gathering. Since it's part of Earth Day, it's best to be on the Earth instead of in the classroom. I mean, it can be on the gravel too, but it's going to be outside here instead of inside, just to start here. And before I begin, I just want to explain a little bit what this feature is. So the feature is an octopus, and it was assembled at the time of the campus dedication. And as part of the campus dedication, this octopus was created to provide a connection between the mountain to the sea. And so the pohakus are gathered in protocol and as such. And some of these pohakus are gathered up from Hualalai. And some of these pohaku stones are gathered from this area here. And a few of them were also gathered from the ocean area, from Keoholi to be more specific. So there's a representation of Mauka to Makai here on this campus, and a sense of place and connection here. And the ahu also serves as a depository for the people for the dedication of these buildings. So we had a dedication of these buildings. We had a ceremonial cutting of the umbilical cord of the pico, just like they would have in earlier days. But instead of a grass house with a thatch over the doorway, they would cut it just as they would cut the pico or the umbilical cord of a child as a representation of the child being born. And so as part of the dedication of the classrooms, you can see one of the pico there. So these pico lays are set at certain buildings here, and these buildings all have names associated with different plants from this area. And it's a representation of the kupuna, or the ancestors of this area. And so the lays all reflected the names of the buildings and the plants from these areas. And so the pico are cut during this dedication and opening up Palamanui, and then part of the pico, as it was cut, was brought here, and so this serves also as a depository for the pico for the buildings. And then at the end of the semester, we're going to take the rest of the lay, and then we're going to cut them back into the land, just as you would a umbilical cord of a child, deposit it back into the land, or in some cases, take it down to the ocean, or take it down to a river or lake, or take it up into the high mountains, deposit the pico. So that's the context of why this ahu is here. The ahu is also a connection from Wakea, from Sky Father to Papahana Moku to Earth Mother. And so we figured it's best just to begin here, to start here if we're at Palamanui. And we'd like to thank all those who gather here today to assist in this recognition of Earth Day. As we know, if you're in Hawaii, every day is an Earth Day for us as Kanaka, or as people of this land. So we thank everyone for contributing, whether it's planting here, or there was pulling in invasive weeds and other things to beautify this land and beautify this campus. And we thank you all for being here. And so the puli, or the prayer to offer, is just to offer us greetings and gratitude for being here today, and for those who cannot be here. And to just reconnect from the mountains to the sea, and from above to below, and that's what's going to be offered today.
Ia pauroa piri awa kea, piri no hoi me papana moku e ma waina. Ia pauroa piri na piko luna o waina o lalo me kia roha me ka mani no kia mua. Ia pauroa hui pui e iuka I kai mai hula lai a hiki no I ke ahole, ke ahole no hoi. Ia pauroa hui pui e me kia roha me ka mana ma waina na tukune o hana o kia aina, kia wahi o kona. Yo pili no hoi e te kona I kai o kua, kona I kama o ki o ki kai ma lino o ki o kona. Hui pui e kam pālam nui. E lām, I kam ālama lama I kare, ki hui no tākua pauroa, me te roha me ka mana no tākua. Maharu nui a pauroa, maharu nui no tio. Me te hui ana, maharu nui a pauroa. Hui no, hui pui e no, me te roha me ka mana, ko uru no te aina, no ka aloha no ka aina hui kuia no tātua kaurua. Mahara nui a kaurua, arono tātou, arono tātou, arono tātua kaurua. Āmama, āmama, uai. So I say greetings to you all here at Palamanui. And as we go throughout the day, and perhaps our speakers will speak about the elama trees and so forth. But the word lama also means enlightenment. Take the word ma'alama lama or lama is to be enlightened, and so it's more so appropriate that the name of this place is called Palamanui, and the word lama, as you see, we have some elama and some lama trees that have been planted. We thank you folks for being here and being enlightened and connecting back with Papahana Moku, with the Mother Earth, and with everything that's connected to it. So we say mahalo to all of you folks for being here today. Mahalo.
And please, again, this is for Naleo. I'm Ron Aronson. I'll be the MC. We're today at Palamanui, University of Hawaii at Palamanui, doing the Earth Day lecture series that we had last year. It's our second year of doing it. First year at Palamanui. Real pleased with that. And our first speaker is Dr. Marty Fletcher, who is the director of Palamanui.
Thank you, Ron, and welcome everyone in aloha.
Aloha.
And this is just wonderful. I mean, we've had a lot happen over the last year. We've got this campus built, up and running, started classes, which is our primary function. But to make that function really work, and to tie in with some of the missions of our educational program, which includes sustainability and respect for the aina, respect for the culture, and the knowledge that we need to navigate the way forward in this new world that we've got to deal with in a more Kona way. So to have events here like this is just wonderful. The campus itself is conceived as a sustainable place, a place that's friendly to the earth. We want it to also reflect the aina and respect what was here and what is, and to represent and acknowledge that this land has a history and it has their kapuna that are here, and that everything is in a harmonious way, but in an energetic way, and that's the way we want to engage with the community. So we don't want to just be university campus, castle on the hill. We want to be a place where the whole community can come and get involved in various ways, to get involved and learn about how to take better care of our community and our aina. And today I couldn't think of a better kind of activity to do that. I also want to mention too that in addition to this, we welcome community members to get involved with us on a continuing basis as we're going to be developing and restoring and making the landscape around this campus work and not only respect this location, this special place, but also to fit in with our curriculum. We have curriculum in science, we have curriculum in Hawaiian lifestyles. We have curriculum in culinary arts and related issues of food development and resource development and things like that. So we want to make sure that we let the community come and make an impact on this place as it develops, so that you feel welcome here and invested here, and then we can also enhance our educational mission, which is ultimately to create better pathways and outcomes for the members of our community that haven't really had an obvious, easy to recognize and access educational pathway in the past. So it's a very important event today, and I appreciate you all being here. It's also a nice event. As you can see, I've been out interacting with the Aina myself, and I think we're going to have just the right mix of a little bit of activity and work and contribution. And thank you to everybody. And I had some brothers sweating with me down there to give a little care to the volunteer fire brigade in respect of the work that they've done, even recently saving this brand new campus from a threatening bushfire and being good neighbors to us. So with that, I'll just make way for the other speakers to present and share their knowledge.
Our next speaker is Hannah Kihanale Springer. She's come Aina Kaupeleu lands, and she'll be talking about generations of living in the Kaha lands.
Aloha mai kako. Oa no Hana Kihalani Springer. Oa no ka pula pula o nā pula pula o kō mā kō aina hānau o ke kaha kainoa. A aia o ke kaha, mai a hono ko hawiki i ka au au hema, mā waho o puu ana hulu i ka au au a kau. No laila, aloha mai nā pula pula mai, aloha mai ka aina mai, aloha mai ka. Aia o Palamanui, i ka poli o nā aina kaha. Here we are today at Palamanui, which is situated in the midst of the Kaha lands, which are that part of North Kona that extends from Honoku Hawiki in the south through Pu'uana Hulu in the north. There are Kaha lands, the dry lands, the lands on the leeward side of the islands, on all of the islands. Have any of us heard of Ke Kaha Kauai? Right? There were kaha lands on all of the islands. This aina kaha is further described as Ke Kaha Waioleia. The kaha lands, this region, but further, Wai water ole without. That this land is described as being without water does not mean that there are those of us that are truly the offshoots, the pula pula. When we describe ourselves as the pula pula, pula pula are like the emergent shoots of the uala, the sweet potato. They bring nutrition to the people and beauty to the landscape. So even here in these dry lands, as I look about, I see the a'ali'i and the alahe'e and the name Palamanui, referring to that greenery of this landscape that we have long known. In our time here, we've seen an island, we've seen chiefs rise and fall. We've seen an island nation born and die before its time. We see political parties wax and wane, elected and appointed officials come and go, but yet we remain here. Here we have been from the time when we were followers to the time when we were leaders. We've been here as fishermen and farmers. We've been here as goat herders and cowboys and cowgirls. But here we stay. And we stay here because of our, if you will, ingenuity. To live in a dry land further described as being without water has required countless generations of people with the ability to cope, to respond nimbly to the circumstances of the landscape and the climate of it, so that we can thrive here. The offshore waters have been in the past and are today rich with bounty. We can see the fishing boats that gather still off of Keahole, off of Haleohi'u, off of Kalaio Keahole. To live on this land, it's required a little more ingenuity than it's taken to find protein out in the ocean. So how was it that we were able to stay here? Along the shoreline were basal springs, create water columns that are fresher, discernibly more fresh than the saltwater body around them. We were able to use those. Perhaps the most famous in our history is the waters of Kane, where the Kona Village Resort used to be. It's a story that comes from the Wamamau, the distant past, from that time where gods and men were not only related, but they interacted actively and on a regular basis with one another. So Kane, in one of his visits to his people of the Kahalands out there at Ka'upulehu, Ka'unupulehu, Ka'imupulehu, Akeakua, Ka'upulehu, all of the ways that our homeland might be further described, each of those ways relating the relationship in the story of Ka'unupulehu, relationship between Kanaka and Pele, Waiakane, the relationship between the Kanaka and Kane, Kane, the patron of fresh water, Kane who allowed us not only to become established here, but to remain here. So when Kane provided for the people during a time of drought, a column of fresh water that they could access by taking a water gourd, empty, going down to the rocky reef where the water issued out of, removing the lid of the water gourd, letting the gourd fill, covering it, returning it to the surface with water that could sustain the people during dry times. It's an ingenuity. It's an adaptation to environment. In the uplands, when water stopped falling out of the sky, we noticed that there were drips in the lava tubes. And even until my mother's time, there was a redwood tank that had been built in a lava tube where once troughs, va'a, if you will, or umehe, captured the drip of water during rainy times as it would percolate through the top layer of the earth and fall into the lava tubes and be collected there for dry times when we needed water. We could go to those places. The anakulu, the ana, the caves where the water dripped, were known. They were recognized landmarks. We find them in Boundary Commission testimonies. Some of us may golf, or at least drive past Makalei, which takes its name from a boy who found such a cave that allowed his family to thrive in this dry land, known as being without water. We talked before about the interaction between the creative forces and Kanaka. So we live in a landscape shaped perhaps by the most dynamic of all forces, the volcano. In the time of my great-great-great-great-grandparents, Pele came last to Kona. She came and found the people not as hospitable, perhaps, as she would have preferred. Have any of us here, you cannot answer, have any of us here heard of the pond of Pa'aea? Some of us have. It was that fish pond that was where the Keahole Airport is situated now. The Hawaiian language newspapers have described the pond of Pa'aea as being 3 miles long and 1 mile wide, and some people go, really? You all add on Hawaiians or what? Hyperbole is certainly a means by which memories of one generation, and they can be superimposed on the memories of others. There was a large fish pond named Pa'aea, which was where the Keahole Airport is now. There are stories associated with the coming of Pele to the landscape, such as the pond of Pa'aea, but I'm not going to take our time with that today. In the uplands at Hu'ehu'e, just below the Mamalahoa Highway, was the breadfruit grove of Kamehaikana. Kamehaikana was a patron of fertility and growth, and that there was a breadfruit grove in her name in the uplands of Hu'ehu'e speaks to the northernmost aspects of what we might describe as the Kona field system. Now the rich Kona field system with the Kalaulu and all of that is further to the south, but that there was this breadfruit grove in the name of Kamehaikana in the uplands of Hu'ehu'e is a significant thing. In one fell swoop, however, with the coming of Pele to the landscape and the flow of lava from Puhia Pele, which came to be where the breadfruit grove of Kamehaikana was, the fish pond of Pa'aea was filled in as well. The traditional economy of the region was impacted tremendously. Kamehameha immediately and nimbly responded by marshaling his resources and causing there to be built at Kiholo, a fish pond that was 600 acres underwater. Now this comes from a description of visiting English missionary William Ellis. We know that the Brits are not hyperbolic, so it must have been a 600-acre fish pond out there. 640 acres is a square mile. So it gives us an idea of the scale at which food production has been possible here. In 1859, a Mauna Loa eruption flowed and filled Kamehameha's pond at Kiholo, and native intelligence, native sensibility, native politics, economics had shifted such that although there may have been places that ponds could have been built, or a pond could have been built again, no fish pond was built following the destruction of the 1859 lava flow. Now, in our generations here, we have a firefighter in the family, a homemaker in the families, resources managers, educators, we had a judge, we had a classically trained musician. But we continue here, telling us in this brief time, I've shared with you a little bit, the lessons, the challenges, the accomplishments, and the failures from one generation to the next, the lips of one to the ears of the next. Now, just in conclusion, you've heard me talk about the vai'ole'ia nature of this land without water. Well, among the things that I've done is trade talk time for spa time out at Wallaway Resort. I thought it was, you know, just a brilliant stroke, just genius. They said, well, can you come and do staff enrichment? I said, love to, don't have the time to. We'll pay you a pretty penny. Sorry, I need time more than I need money. What would you do with your time if you had it to do? I said, well, I'd get a massage. And so we've got a spa. You come and talk to us, and you can come and have spa time. So I said, shoot. Always talking about this notion of a waterless land and living within our means within it. And not just living here, but sustaining ourselves from one generation to the next. So that's always my talk, always. You folks who know me, you've been hearing me do this for decades. So there I am, doing my talk at staff enrichment. And I go to the spa, and they've got the menu of things, and I've done this, I know that. But there's this thing I wasn't familiar with, the Vichy shower? You know, sounds kind of chic. So I'll do that. Well, they slathered me with oil, they rubbed me with salts, they heated me up, they wrapped me up, they unwrapped me. And to get the oil and the salt off, they brought this bar, T-shaped bar, with seven shower heads on it. And they opened the gates on me, and I was like, this feels so bad, Anna. So I determined that I would always tell this story as my penance. The enticement of the world, the enticement of those things that lead us away from our sensibility is mighty. And it is strong. But at doesn't mean we cannot have a Vichy shower in our lives. It just means we do it during the rainy season. I did make that suggestion to Walla High Resort. They said, well, thank you very much. And I think it's still on the menu all of the time. But for me, the lesson in that story is living within our means does not mean that we cannot live well. It only means that we need to live with intelligence. And that's what Palamanui represents, the establishment of this facility and the faculty here, that we can hone our skills to live with intelligence, live well, and thrive here in these lands called Ke Kaha Waiole Nei. Mahalo nui.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Our next presenter will be Christina Hoffman. Christina is a professor of biology here at Palamanui. She's going to be talking about education and stewardship. Please come on up.
My talk's real fast. Excuse me. For a while, we had a guest here in Hawaii called David Klausnitzer, who worked for Natural Resources Conservation Service. And he, one time I went out in the field with him, and he said something to me that has always struck home about how it's so tragic how no one knows that Hawaii is an ecological tragedy, that's a world-class ecological tragedy. And it's just because of a lack of education. So I had my environmental science students for my class this semester do a survey and ask students on campus how many were aware that the surrounding area had a dry land forest. And as you can see, overwhelmingly, most people weren't aware of it. And then I sent my students out Imiani Street. They marched up and down asking residents if they knew anything about the dry land forest here. And same thing, you know, very little knowledge. So this is a bad picture of the whole area of Palamanui, and this is a better scheme. This is where we are right now. This is the future plan. And one thing I just wanted to point out that to me as a biologist is so important is the Palamanui Forest Reserve, which is the only dry land forest that's actually regenerating in practically the entire state of Hawaii. So we have so few fragments of dry land forest left, and gosh, everybody knows with all the arson we've had lately. So this is what the campus looked like this morning before we pulled the fountain grass, and now it's pretty much devoid of the area. And unfortunately, fountain grass is such a fire hazard. The courtyard was planted with a few native species, and that's what we have today up until this point. So my students did one more survey. This is not quite correct. We discovered three more native plants in the fountain grass that we've since then uncovered. So there's actually five, but compared to the number of alien species, the proportions are dismal. And so here's a llama tree just over there, surrounded by fountain grass. And I learned when I went to the Dry Forest Symposium this February that fountain grass, if it's growing at the base of any of these dry land plants, will actually force the plant itself to dig deeper roots to get at the water, and so the fountain grass gets all this surface water. You take the fountain grass out, and the roots can develop on these llama trees right close to the surface, which is really nice. So we've been trying, Richard, wherever you are, we've been trying to get all the, liberate some of these trees from the fountain grass. And you can see the task is quite daunting. You still have quite a ways to go. Another evil plant that surrounds the area, so it's like we're surrounded by all these aggressive alien species that are just waiting to move in. And so this is a lifelong process, this Earth Day planting and then invasive species removal. And tree tobacco was actually brought in by one bulldozer, I think, on the Mauka side of Hualalai Resort was where the first seeds germinated, and now it's pretty much spread. Interestingly enough, this plant is in the tobacco family, and the nightshade family is a great host for one of the few species of native moth we have left. So blackbird's moth likes to hang out on these plants. Another plant we have that's got an amazing habitat range is mullein, which is a European herb brought to Hawaii. it grows from sea level to 10,000 feet. If you go up Mauna Kea in the uplands and the alpine climate zones, the entire understory is almost monotypic mullein. And so some other things that, you know, it's so exciting to be here now, finally at this campus, and to be able to have all, we have our work cut out for us. And not just for me, but future generations, because we're never gonna get rid of the fountain grass. But we can start, all right? So we put a dent in it today. And then we can slowly replace and plant with native species. And so I have a couple, and of course, llama, which is what Palamanui is named after, which is a beautiful tree. It's in the ebony family. Its fruits are related to persimmon. You can't eat them. They tend to be fairly astringent in flavor. But we're going to be growing a lot of llama trees. It's a long-term project. Alahee, which miraculously the goats don't like, which is great. Nio, these are all trees that exist in this area. A'ali'i, a beautiful shrub, also part of the dryland understory. And then a real rare, these look kind of terrible on large, but kawila, that's a really rare tree with a very hard wood. It's got wood so dense it actually sinks, whereas most wood floats. So extremely slow growing. There's Sam Gaughan, I don't know if you can see him. So pretty old picture, a pretty old tree, I mean. Pepe, also a really beautiful understory shrub, and a lot of people have money trees in their yards. They could easily be planting jalapepe. It's an endangered plant. And so Richard does this with his class. I do this with my students. We spend our Saturdays volunteering and doing restoration work. And it's a slow, laborious process. That's what it is, a slow, laborious process, just to get the fountain grass out and to get these trees in. And one of the reasons fountain grass is so bad for the area is, first of all, it comes from Kenya originally, right? And it's a beautiful ornamental grass. You can find it in any seed catalog, believe me. It does really well in Southern California too. But aside from being a fire threat, another problem with fountain grass is it's allelopathic, and that's a trait a lot of plants have that is really competitive. So these plants have chemicals in them that prevent other plants from growing. So it has to be manually removed. That's what we did this morning, just pulling away. I learned recently that although thousands of seeds remain behind, they tend to be short-lived, which is encouraging about fountain grass. This is the fire that was at Palamanui, or near Palamanui, a couple months ago. And again, the arson that, I'm sure it's arson, it can't possibly be just all natural causes, you know, but up on the Napa Road, all the willy-willy that just died. It's just so sad. And you know, fountain grass, it's just such a powerful, it just catches fire so easily, it just burns so hot. So my students and I started to get rid of it on the other side, on the south end of the campus, because it grows right up to it, and you know, it'll take out anything if that place catches fire. So we managed to get rid of quite a bit of it near the building, and it made us feel good doing that. And as you can see in the background, there's only thousands more fountain grass plants to remove, right? And so one of the things about conservation education, and that's another thing, this place presents such a great opportunity now for the future, for stewardship, for all kinds of restoration projects that we can do with the college here. And so the thing is to try to get students and faculty to have that personal connection, that sense of place. Why do you want to invest in this place? Why is it worth coming on your free Saturday morning to sweat out there and pull the fountain grass? What's it worth? You know, that kind of thing. And so again, to feel that obligation towards the future, because that's what we're doing this for. And so we got the Democrats next door, so we got this whole cool place here now, conveniently situated out of town, so you don't have to deal with traffic, especially if you're coming north. You know, we have the potential for research. We've got the reserve behind us. Possibly we can structure an Amakihi corridor. Amakihi is the Hawaiian honeycreeper that's just up the road, 2 miles away from here. And it's showing resistance to avian malaria and avian pox. So maybe we can, you know, encourage that bird to move down here. And then do what we're doing today, coming on our Saturdays. Working with other agencies, and again, having that personal state in Hawaii Nei. That's what I think is really, really important. So we started a fountain grass patrol here. We're going to keep it going, probably next semester, because we're coming to the close of this semester. We will be having having gatherings, so I will let you know. And BYOP, because it's way easier to get the fountain grass out. All right.
I found when being around here in Palamanui, it's the excitement everybody has for this place and for what they're doing. Our next speaker is Richard Stevens. He's a professor of history here, but he's better known, I think, for being the coordinator of the trail restoration here at Palamanui, the coordinator of the reforestation of the Veterans Cemetery, and the coordinator of the Koa reforestation of Olma Forest. He's a tree guy, Richard Stevens.
Aloha mai kakou. And welcome to the Age of Restoration. Just listen to this. Our students over the past two decades now have planted 50,321 trees, and that includes ones that were planted today. So, I say Age of Restoration because the 20th century got the unfortunately well-deserved nickname of Age of Anxiety. The century that we were all born in. The century before that, the Industrial Revolution, is the century that started us off on the path that's brought us so much environmental trouble today. So thinking of this new century as the age of restoration, I mean restoration of culture, restoration of nature, restoration of the lowland dry forest, restoration of the uplands, this is a wonderful thing for us to be doing. It's really like a sacred job. And just to show you how tuned in we are to those kupuna who set the example for this, when we got the idea to reforest the Veterans Cemetery 3 miles to the north of us here in a battered landscape, the very first person that we called to ask whether that would be a good thing to do is this lady right here, Hannah Springer. And she gave some wonderful words of advice about that, in which she said, why not make a cultural garden for the 21st century? In other words, include some of the plants that the first Polynesians brought here too. And so this has been a wonderful thing for us to work with, that kind of advice and that kind of impetus that really we got from tuning into keiki okahaina, such as Hannah. So big mahalo, that's a continuing work of love out there that really your blessing started off for us. Trees and trails go together perfectly, and the discovery out here by the archaeologist in about 2001 of a Malcolm Mackay trail was electrifying to those of us that are trail nuts, like me, passionate about those mysterious lines across the landscape and what they connected and what they have to tell us. I heard Hannah use the word ingenuity at least three times in her talk, and it reminded me of a wonderful quote by Debbie Chang, who was the first head of the state Na'ala LA Trails and Access Program. And Debbie, in her book on the trails of Pu'uanakulu, Hannah's territory again, and Hannah was very much involved in the production of that important book, Debbie wrote that trails are living artifacts, cultural treasures that show the ingenuity and the survivability of the Hawaiians in nature. And that is a real key to the value of these trails. Also the connections that both Hannah and Christina mentioned. Trails are all about connections. From the mountain to the sea, from the past to the present, from the present to the future, that's what trails are about. And so we feel them running actually right to our heart as we get involved in them. So for the last 2 years, our students have been leading the restoration, and we've involved many other community partners in this. Probably about 800 people have now taken part in 2 years of working to restore this trail, mostly pulling fountain grass. We've had a lot of practice doing that now. But that trail right now, our slogan out there is the more you uncover, the more you discover. And what we are finding is a lot of what Hannah talked about is the ways that the Hawaiians used the land and its wonderful plants as a way to have a bountiful agriculture here in lands that did not receive that much rainfall. And so the kind of clearing that we're doing there, we recently had a wonderful visit from Dr. Noah Lincoln, who gave the presentation just a few nights ago, Wednesday actually, here at the Civic Center about the Kona field system. What we have here is the Palamanui version of the fields of the Kona field system, and it's quite different from, say, the field system in Kahului, where my wife and I are restoring Kamehameha School's farm lease. So we have wonderful discoveries that are going on here, and it's our students that are really making this possible with their labors out there. So this is an exciting thing to be part of, trees and trails as the core of our ways to energize our students, to give them a feeling of real value when they go out there. Everyone that plants trees with us, we ask them to dedicate their trees to someone special. So our reforestation efforts at the Veterans Cemetery, we have taken to call the Forest of Loved Souls. And we do the same thing here. Actually, today we started off that kind, or continued really, the reforestation. It started with all these beautiful landscape native plants that have been put in here. And so getting people involved so they have a personal stake in this, as well as that cultural stake and that environmental stake. And we invite all of you to take part in this, to come out and see this marvelous trail, to see the secrets that it is whispering to us as we unlock more of them with the continued cleaning. The reforestation of the uplands, in 2004, we were given the mission by the Division of Forestry and Wildlife to restore the upper canopy to the O'oma Forest. This is the Maka'ula O'oma tract of the Honua'ula Forest Reserve. At the end of Makahi Street, you'll find a trail that goes into the forest there, and the thousands of koa trees now that are part of that ecosystem are restoring the upper canopy. The koa had disappeared over the years. You had just the very narrow canopy from the remaining ohia trees. Now you're getting that broad and beautiful canopy that the koa tree provides. So these are wonderful things that are happening here. And again, all accolades to our students who, again, are the ones who come and provide the labor for this. And so we hearken back often too to those students who were part of our older inhabitation next to the corner pocket in Kealakekua. Hallelujah that we are here now and not there. But in those days with those students, we had focus groups led by this lady right here, Ann Kern, our speech teacher. And those students said, when hearing about, we're going to have a new campus out here, what is it you would most like to do or be most involved in? Their number one thing was, we want to restore the dryland forest there. The dryland forest is something that really reaches out into people's hearts. There are so many people, we have a dryland forest symposium here every year. It's something that touches, and you saw some of the reasons in those pictures that Christina had there. The wonderful llama tree, which may turn out to be the oldest living angiosperm or flowering tree, beating out the mighty oak of North America and the mighty ohia of Hawaii. Just recently, the ohia seems to have passed the oak in terms of living a bit longer, maybe 500 to 600 years. The oak is 400 to 500, but there are some indications about the llama tree that it may live to be 1,500 years old. If that is true, it blows away number two and number three, and it's this gorgeous tree. You will see Dr. Noah Lincoln was very surprised about the concentration of llama or a llama trees that we have out here, these beautiful, venerable trees that were an integral part of the Hawaiian's agricultural system. You have agricultural mounds that we're finding when we pull out the fountain grass, and you have a beautiful ancient llama tree that is really the foundation of that mound. So agroforestry, that which is being promoted now by the U.S. Department of Agriculture here in a big way, agroforestry, the blending of forests with agricultural crops in order to keep trees in the landscape, to keep as many trees on this earth as we can, to plant more trees, and to find the value that they have in being able to help agriculture, is exactly what all of our ancestors did, and certainly here, where it's teaching this wonderful lesson to us. So we invite you to come and to enjoy. We go out to the trail at least once a week. We'll continue doing this throughout the summer, and certainly when our semester starts again in the fall, we'll have a big rush of student help out there also. Thank you for being here today. Thank you for loving the earth, and thanks for taking a few koa trees when you go. We've given away almost 1,000 trees now. We started out with 1,000. We've got about 150 out there left. Feel free to take a couple of koa trees with you, and they will do a great job at carbon sequestration and the many other things that trees do to help us out in this age of restoration. Mahalo.
Boy, that's a guy with some passion, huh? Yeah. Love it, love it. Also, if you contact me, he'll tell you where you can get one of those hats. Our next speaker is Jill Wagner. Jill is a forestry consultant. She designs gardens. She's also the leader of the Hawaii, director of the Hawaii Island Seed Bank, and she'll be talking about that today. She's also the coordinator for the Palamanui Dry Land Forest. And aside, I was on the design group that designed the Palamanui subdivision 15 years ago, and we worked with the UH after that. And the first thing we did was we isolated the dry land forest area and separated that away from the development, and then we developed around it. So we're really proud of that.
Okay.
Nice to see you, Jill. So welcome to our place.
Okay.
Thank you. I am here to talk about the Hawaii Island Seed Bank. And the Hawaii Island Seed Bank is a public seed bank on the Big Island. And it provides services for landowners, farmers, restoration managers, and people who collect and save seeds and do any kind of land work. And the big important thing is that we need to save seeds. We have not developed seed banking in our minds and in our practice in Hawaii, and we are a little behind in collecting and saving seeds. So the idea for the seed bank is to provide a place for seeds to be taken care of. So what the seed bank does is it has partners, and those partners have a bin in which they can store their seeds. The seeds are cleaned from the husk, and it is dried to a certain moisture temperature. You can't just take seeds and put it in a refrigerator or just put it in a closet or something. And what happens is it loses viability over time. But if you dry it to a certain moisture level, you can store it for many, many years. So you can store it either in refrigeration or in freezing. And so the seed bank does that. It takes these seed deposits in and provides these services for partners. And there are a number of partners, including the Department of Hawaiian Homelands, the National Park Service, Palamanui Forest, there are many. And the Kona Library provides free seeds to the community for doing agriculture, and we're developing that. They have a seed library, and you can go and get seeds. And the Kohala Center, Hawaii Public Seed Initiative, is also a partner. So there is a a larger group in Hawaii. It's called the Hawaii Seed Bank Partnership, and that is led by Lion Arboretum and the Army, and there is a seed bank developing on every island, and we come together and we prioritize what kinds of research needs to be done and shares information on seed banking to anyone who wants to collect and save seeds. And so that is part of a larger thing that's happening in the United States, and that is called SOS, Seeds of Success. And Seeds of Success is a program that is in every state in the United States. And every state is creating a volunteer base in which people go out and collect native seeds and save seeds. And I, my vision is to have a, to start an internship program through this college at Palamanui to teach students about the importance of saving seeds and to collect and save seeds that are around us. It's wonderful to do restoration, and I do it, but one great resource and tool that we have is to also save seeds for the future. We don't know what the future will be. We don't know 10 years, 20 years, or 50 years. And so if we have a resource for future generations that they can build upon, it's very important. And the other thing about that is that, you know, when you look out here at this dry forest landscape, it's greatly diminished, as we know, but there are trees out there, important trees. And an example of that is a willy-willy tree. There are willy-willy trees out in this landscape. Those trees are very old. They're senescent. They're probably at the later end of their life. They're dying, and we know this. When we do restoration, we know that we're seeing trees go away and dying, probably due to, you know, the impacted environment, and they're old. And so I think it's really important for us to remember to collect those seeds. Those are the future. Those are the founder trees for everything we do in the future. And the beauty of those seeds, just as an example, is that they store for many, many years. So we can propagate and do planting and continue to expand a healthy environment around us. And we can also take some of that and save that seed. So that's what I want to convey. That's my focus, and as well as restoration. And I want to thank you for inviting me.
Oh, nice to have you. Thank you. Greg Barber is the executive director of NELHA, National Energy Laboratory of Authority, and he's going to give us an update. Just before that, Greg, I wanted to let everybody know that our speakers are going to bring them all up here right after Greg. If you have any questions for them, we'll do that. I think we'll have a little bathroom break at that point, okay? And then we'll have our keynote speaker. Okay, thanks. Thanks, Greg.
Thank you.
See you, man.
Okay, so this is my PowerPoint presentation. Hopefully you can see it. Thank you for inviting me here today. The people that had the vision a long time ago, these University of Hawaii folks and the legislature and Governor Burns and Governor Ariyoshi, they wanted to establish something that would fit in with the West Hawaii region, with the visitor industry, and developed, I think, incredible vision, a clean energy test bed with a focus on marine science. I think it fits in very well, with the community, providing, jobs and training in an area that you typically haven't seen in the past, and by that I mean marine science and the sustainability. And so we've done very well over the years. We have about 900 acres onshore, and we have 3,000 acre research corridor offshore. Basically, that's where we have deep sea water pipelines and basically on the ocean floor. We have about, I would say two-thirds of the park is now developed. Majority of the land on Kehole Point is really aquaculture. We are a hatchery, really, for a lot of shrimp, oysters, clams, and fish that are grown out somewhere else. It's quite expensive to grow out on the land, and but we provide that those seedlings or rootstock to be grown out somewhere else. Of course, we have the Monk Seal Hospital there. They've done very well. I think it's the most endangered species in the world. And I think they've helped out over 10 seals in the last couple of years. I put that up there just because it's a nice picture. We do pump a lot of seawater. The original concept was bring the cold seawater ashore and the warm seawater ashore. It's the difference in the temperature to create energy, and then the clean baseload renewable energy, that OTEC. And then also the bigger part of it is that you use that water, you know, to do this aquaculture, to all these secondary uses. And so you get a lot more benefit from just not only producing the clean energy, but also being able to do marine science on shore. We do pump a lot of water, but we have our own water quality lab. We sample 120 sites every 90 days, both onshore and offshore. We've been doing that for over 20 years, so we have a huge database that people can access. We haven't seen any change in the offshore water or the water that we sample. One of the biggest areas that we're focusing on is the research campus. It's a 6-acre site at the end of the road on right at Kehole Point, and we're trying to develop that and give it a more research campus feel. We really want to bring closer ties with Palamanui, and I think they're teaching some classes down there this year, we welcome that, and we'd like to strengthen our ties with Palamanui. And I'm a big believer in internship programs. For me, that's how I got started. With a internship program with EPA, throwing a bottle over a river and doing water sampling when I was in college. And I learned a lot about, that's my first degree in environmental science. I learned a lot about it, and I stuck with it. And I really think that internship programs will help the children in Hawaii and understand what they want to do. And we had, I think, 6 interns last summer. We encouraged the businesses in the park to develop internship programs, and they have. And I'd like to see more internship programs, especially in the area of marine science. And I know some of the businesses have really benefited from the interns that they've gotten from both here and in Hilo in the marine science area. We're just finishing up incubator building. We received funding from the federal government to renovate one of our buildings, and so the name of this building is Hale Iako. The Iako is, of course, the connector between the canoe and the outrigger, is that correct? And probably didn't use the right words there, but you get the concept. But the idea of the Iako is we want to connect, the land and the resources that we have there with the people of Hawaii, and to be able to help people develop you know, in the areas of marine science and sustainability. The building will be open within a couple of months. Clean tech, we do have a OTEC tower there now, Mackay Ocean Engineering. It's one of the only two test facilities in the world. It is connected to the grid. They have been running since August of last year, and they are producing that energy. From what I understand, they have learned a lot. I know people have heard a lot about OTEC over the years. But I've drank the Kool-Aid, I've been there 5 years, and I really believe in it. It is clean energy, it is base load energy, and it does provide a lot of benefits, and I hope to see it come to fruition soon. We currently use a little bit under a megawatt, our load for power, and we are going to do a feasibility study of building our own OTEC facility to provide power for our pumping system, and my stretch goal is to be net zero within 5 years by adding OTEC and additional renewables from solar. The Hawaiian Natural Energy Institute is developing a hydrogen production and fueling station that hopefully will be up and running by the end of this year. This is the county's bus that is almost finished. It will be finished shortly, and I believe that'll be running in the Kona area. This is a rendering of the hydrogen production facility that will be down at Kahului Point, and I believe it'll be the first hydrogen production and storage facility with a fueling station that will not be on a military base in Hawaii, and I would hope to see this area grow. I'm a big proponent of hydrogen. I think it has a lot of potential for the future, and we hope to become more of a test bed for hydrogen technologies in the future. We do have the Kahului Solar Power Company that went bankrupt a couple of years ago. We've now entered into approval in principle with Edison Heliostats. They will refocus that project into a heliostat project, and their technology is to use the rocks to store the thermal energy, and they hope to be able to release all of the energy stored during the day. And during the peak hours, they're well-funded, they're Series B round, and they went through the Energy Accelerator and received funding from the Energy Accelerator. So if you're gonna test thermal energy from rocks, I think Kona might be the best place in the world to do that. We certainly have no shortage of rocks. Last thing is, this is the new highway. We are building a new road to Ka'ininani. We closed bids yesterday, and five of the six bids were within our budget. So I believe that we will start this road in the next couple of months, and hopefully be finished by the time Queen Ta'ahumanu Highway is finished. It will go through this area, which is what we call Ocean Centerpiece. It's long-term development for us, and we would like to develop a sustainability mall, not a typical commercial industrial area. We would like to build an area that would be our brand, anything sustainable, anything renewable, using the deep sea water for cooling, using the solar, using the hydrogen. We would just like this area to become a living lab for sustainable technologies and green technologies. Anything that has been developed in the park could be sold there, and I think it would be a great way to show people the potential of all these sustainable technologies in one place, where they could come and see all these new green and sustainable technologies. And that's all I have. Thank you very much.
it up to questions like I promised. And so you can just turn, you guys don't have to come up here. Anybody have any questions of our presenters this morning? Please.
I actually do. I have a question for
him. Great.
How is the hydrogen going to be stored on the bus?
Up here for the answers. So these are compressed hydrogen buses, so they'll be at 350 bar, I believe, and they'll also have, I think they also have electric batteries in them, so I believe, not so sure, but they're a hybrid, but they can run 100% on the hydrogen. And my understanding is the county will be using them in the Kona area. There's one bus that'll be here in Kona, and there'll be two buses at Volcano Park that the National Park Service will be running in the park. And this hydrogen production facility would be for all three of those buses.
The Ocean Center looks quite remarkable.
Thank you.
Yeah, so can you say just a little bit more of that went by so fast? So that's like a business park focused on green and sustainable business and showcasing.
That's the concept. You know, this shaded area is that 80 acres that I'm showing here. This is Ka'imi'ani. This is the highway, and this is our current entrance at Makako Bay. The thing is, when the new highway is done, we won't have access to the northbound lanes of the highway. So this will become our new entrance over here at Ka'imi'ani. That's just a conceptual idea that we have. And, you know, I tell you, you know, the fact that they've developed this technology park over the last 40 years. You know, if you would have asked me 40 years ago to invest money in building a green, sustainable industries, technology park, marine science park, I don't think I would have been able to see the vision, but the people stuck with it. I think it's a real treasure for the West Hawaii. There's nothing like it in the world. I mean, we can have things like the Monk Seal Hospital now because of what these people have done. And so the concept is, my concept would be to replicate, you know, something similar for this 80-acre parcel to focus intensely on sustainable technologies and green technologies. How that will happen, it will take us another couple of years, probably 3 to 5 years, before we can tee up this site to get it ready for development. The road will be the first thing that we can do to get it available for development.
Anyone else?
How come it took so long? And then we'll take from the beginning was trying to have renewable energy with that. How come it's taking so long, 4 years, to get to point where anything's even viable?
I'm not sure. I've been here 5 years now. I know that the federal government invested heavily in OTEC in the 70s and in the 80s. I think when the price of oil dropped into the teens in the late 80s, a lot of interest in renewable technologies like OTEC waned significantly. Dried up, and then when we saw the price of oil and the price of energy increase again in, you know, recent years, then there's more interest in OTEC power, and you know, that's the best I can do. I'm not
climate
really
change,
sure.
Change might also play a role.
Pardon?
We didn't have climate change issues 40 years ago. We
that
have them today.
Be. That could be. That's a good point. Yeah,
as well.
It is. You know, it is. I mean, nothing against wind, nothing against solar, and all those other technologies, but it is baseload. It's not intermittent power. What they've shown at Mackay is that You can dial it up and you can dial it down, and you know, the wind and the rain and everything doesn't affect that power, and it's 24/7, which is very attractive to people. Plus, you also have the water that you can use for all these secondary industries. You know, it yeah, the baseload aspect of it is extremely attractive.
There was a project coming up, like a wave action generated energy.
You know, we don't have any wave action projects. I don't think that Kona is a very good site for wave technology demonstration testbed. I think places like Kaneohe on Oahu is where they're focusing wave projects. In the summer, it's, you know, it's like a bad project.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
If you're just joining us on Alejo TV, we're at the 2016 Presentations for Earth Day, and our next speaker is our keynote speaker, Shiwu Sung, is a PhD doctorate at University of Hawaii Hilo. He's been there a couple years. I met him last week. We went over to his lab. He's doing amazing things over there. It's going to be a really exciting talk on ocean pollution, I believe, right? Yeah. Shiwu, you want to come on up? Thanks a lot.
Titles, Hawaiian Ocean Pollution Convention. Okay, we often learn the solution to the pollution is dilution. They have a certain truths about this. Just like the urbanization continue to grow in the human population continue to grow, and so progenic pollutant is beyond the nature dilution. That nature has a self-cleaning capacity, so let's call it dilution capacity. If the people continue to grow, eventually we're going to go over this capacity. What's going to happen next? The environment will start to deteriorate. And pollution prevention is major, is needed after the environment be deteriorated, and then try to slow down this progression. We didn't say to reverse, because so far the population continue to increase, you're never going to reverse. Just slow down the process. We learned that the climate change is a perfect example there. So today my job is to try to understand this item. What is happening, some of the ocean pollution issue tied to the human activity, and then educate the public to the level you can make your own judgment. I'm not going to tell you what is right or wrong, but you can make your own judgment after this presentation, hopefully. So I put a little bit of fundamental part. So look at it right now. Where the pollution come from? Can come from the point source or non-point source. The point source is referred to the network of piping. You can identify the point. Non-point source is pretty much is covered from the surface runoff. You have a precipitation in the east side of the island. They create the surface runoff. Whatever on the surface will carry into the ocean. Okay, that's a point source and non-point source. You can just by definition to understand the point source is probably easier to manage because it has a pipe, you have a spot, you can put in some kind of treatment process, and the non-point source rely on some kind of best practice management. So it's a little bit different story here. So here, talking about the water pollution, what is a different category? I made up this table, talk about all the pollutant category, and oxygen demand material, we will elaborate a little bit more about what it means, so-called oxygen demanding material, nutrient pathogen, suspended solid, salt, toxic metal, and the toxic chemical, and also the heat. Heat will change the nature environment, especially if you're building some kind of power plant or nuclear power plant along the coastline. You use the seawater as the cooling water, then you discharge those elevated temperature water, will cause something damage to the ecosystem. Coral reef, that's well documented. Here it's based on the high, moderate potential low, you can look at it here, but just you learned that the industrial waste, it's a good thing in this island, we don't have a whole lot of industry, they can be
really high in potential if it is properly managed. But one thing stood out here, the nutrient pollution mostly is tied to the agricultural practice. Talking about the fertilizer you put on the land or the animal production, the waste disposal, that kind of stuff. So you can look at here, domestic sewer is relatively low strength. So what is wastewater? By definition, wastewater is, because of the water, it's 99% of water, plus 1% of impurity. There's something other than water in there, we call it wastewater. So it's really just a majority is water. And then look at the impurity. Engineer try to simplify those impurity to the different category. Then we'll make it easy to understand, say, address those different category with different technology to remove those. So we follow that same kind of thinking, give you some layout here, talk about suspended solid, which is referred to particulates. It's something is not soluble. And under this particulate, we have inorganic, organic. We separated particulate, then subcategory, so-called inorganic and organic, okay? In the engineering term, we call it the fixed suspended solid. That's a referred particulate, inorganic particulate, we call it fixed suspended solid. I will elaborate a little bit more. Organic, we call it volatile suspended solid. This is a definition by the engineer. They come up with those definitions. The second category is called a soluble solute. That's a dissolved solid. The stuff will dissolve in the water. Like essentially you put the table salt in the water, it stirred it, it disappeared, right? That still is the impurity, but in the dissolved form. So in this category, we also have inorganic, organic form. And engineer call it the fixed dissolved solid, volatile dissolved solid, okay? And those, as so as the organic portion, you will have the oxygen demand. Why we care this? Because you discharge the organic substance into the receiving stream, river, ocean, they cause that they will, bacteria inside those stream will utilize those organic carbon as a food, and meantime consume the oxygen. Once oxygen consumed, what's going to happen? The fish will die, okay? So that's some kind of things we, as an engineer, instead to understand all the different molecule of organic, we come up with a surrogate measurement, use oxygen demand as a surrogate measurement to talk about how much of the organic carbon present in the wastewater. So oxygen demand is important, but oxygen demand is not just come from the organic organic compound. Nutrient content also is another separate category we often refer to as nitrogen and phosphorus. So they could be organic form or inorganic form, nutrient form, and could be the particulate or soluble, just blended into these four different categories, okay? And they come out with each nutrient can be have a different form. Of course, nutrient can cause eutrophication. That eutrophication, you can just cause algae bloom, and then pH changing the water, and then dissolved oxygen also changing during the day and night, just causes some kind of environmental problem there. So organic nutrient plus ammonia also has oxygen demand. Those are three species that has oxygen demand. But understand this, we can kind of give you two slides to talk about the nutrient pollutant. Use the Mississippi Basin as an example. Okay, that's where I come from, Iowa, and Illinois, the two largest nutrient polluted in the United States, the old discharge Gulf of Mexico. What's happened to the Gulf of Mexico? You look at the dissolved oxygen level, you get it produced over the hypoxia zone, that means the low dissolved oxygen, they will change the ecosystem, the fishery is further away from the coastline, and then you have it, oyster production will damage those kind of things. Those are caused by the nutrient pollution. So that do have some environmental impact in the nutrient. So we talk about two things now. It's so-called nutrient pollution and the organic substance cause the oxygen demand. So this is just a summarize what we just learned from there into this so-called solid metric. Organic VS is a volatile solid. Remember we say volatile refers to organic. They have a particulate portion has a dissolved portion. fixed solid with the inorganic portion has a particulate version and then dissolved version. Remember, we classified it into four different categories divided by two principles. It's organic. Organic means this, divided by particulate and dissolved. So mainly, all the impurity into the four categories, both the four categories. We simplified this in order to make it easy to understand how the things can be addressed individual category. So this is how we constructed the so-called the solid matrix. Suspended solid is including volatile portion and the fixed portion, organic portion, inorganic portion, dissolved solid, organic portion, inorganic portion. Horizontal way, you can say total fixed solid has a particulate plus the soluble, right? That's a come up with this. But the main thing here is a four different category if you want to look at it. Why do I want to talk about this, okay? I'll give you some example here. Talk about typical fixed suspended solid to refer to as a standard silk, which is particulate inorganic, right? This is a so-called the soft inorganic soluble, all kind of salt, right? That's a soft category. So look at the next slide, talking about what is the domestic wastewater, the strength. In here, I highlighted to BOD, suspended solid, and the total caldol nitrogen and the phosphorus. Highlighted in blue is potentially be regulated by the EPA standard. So we refer to this 200, 240, and 10. BOD, 200, suspended solid 200, remember the suspended solid TSS including organic portion, VSS plus inorganic portion, FSS, right? That's recorded in here, and then nitrogen and phosphorus, those are neutron portion. That's our raw municipal sewage. This is the current that we talk about the BOD, since this BOD come out here. What's BOD? BOD is a testing method. We put the series of those BOD bottle with some nutrient there, and then put the wastewater in there. After 5 days, we see how much the oxygen being dissolved, being consumed, and back calculate what is BOD, the oxygen demand, biochemical oxygen demand. Remember it? Oxygen demand, we use the BOD as a surrogate to talk about how much organic in there. So biodegradable portion of the organic carbon can be utilized by the bacteria, and in the meantime, when they utilize and consume the oxygen. More they consume, higher the organic carbon biodegradable portion. That's the surrogate we use that to talk about the organic carbon content, and also the EPA use this as a measurement to regulate it. Wastewater strength as a discharge. So here's the famous 30-30 standard. That is the lowest, the minimum, the national standard for any kind of water discharge to public water, lake, river, estuary, ocean. You have to meet a 30-30 standard. That means it's a minimum requirement. That means you have the treatment plant, you can have a 25 as a limit, but it's not going to be higher than 30. Just minimum requirement. Look at it here. What is in there? BOD and suspended solid. That's it. 30-30 standard refer only two things, BOD suspended solid. And the nutrient portion at this current step is case by case, case specific. If in this place you have well documented has a nutrient problem, they might give you the nutrient limit. But this is it's optional even today. But national EPA already tried to figure out we need to start to regulate the total nitrogen and total phosphate. So far in our nation, if the plant has a nutrient limit, you only have an ammonia discharge limit, not the total nitrogen. Total nitrogen including all the nitrogen species, nitrate, nitrite, organic nitrogen, ammonia combined called the total nitrogen. So far we only have an ammonia discharge limit because ammonia is more potent, cause more damage to the environment. Remember, ammonia has an oxygen demand as well. So we had the picture to tell you, this is when you take a shower, flush your toilet, what's the waste strength, right? 200, 240, 10. you have to meet a 30-30 standard. That's the current standard. So in terms of this 30-30 standard, that means from 200 removed to 30-30, in this picture here, the solid metric is referred to. You need that this two category goes through the treatment process, reduces less than 30. Those two, which is organic portion, this combined, and use the BOD as 5 as a measurement. This one has to be less than 30. Okay, what's happened to this? No regulation. You can think about the salt removal costs a lot. Even this is a pollutant, we cannot afford it, just period. And then eventually discharges to the ocean, we have quite a bit of salt anyway. Okay, so this is left behind. That's a 30-30 standard we talk about today. I want to look at, show you what kind of effort, if you are city as a sewer network, you send it to the city treatment plant. That's a modern sewer treatment process. A lot of the money involved into here to treat it only from 200 to reduce to 30. That's how much money we spend. Do we have this kind of treatment plant in this island? No. Okay? This, I want to show you a little bit. This is a so-called activated sludge system. This second one, that's the two most common one. The modern treatment is trickling filter treatment plant. That's how complex that is. I can talk about it. They have a pre-treatment, primary treatment, secondary treatment. If you have ammonia removal, that's a tertiary treatment. That's a several layer. Then bottom is a sludge treatment process. So they give you the modern design. That's a trickling filter the system looks like. I'll just give you one slide there. And today's my presentation, going to talk about Hawaii coastal water pollution issue. I'm going to address the number one is organic and nutrient pollution, come from the municipal side, come from the different the agricultural practice or whatever. The second issue there is a soil erosion and the silt runoff to the ocean. Because it's a coastal impact to the coastal can be come from those two sources. You can look at it. This is especially on the east side. You have a high precipitation, then silt runoff to the coastal line. You can look at it, what's happened, the impact there. And number three is urban solid waste runoff. That's a typical thing here. How we will talk about this pollution issue and also provide you some of the prevention method. Okay, you can understand what is a possible prevention method. So that's what I call the pollution, coastal pollution and the prevention for my talk here. Then number four is called the emerging contaminants. Okay, that's a stop for you to think about it. Now EPA start to think about this is also has a problem, but you'll be your own judgment after I present this category. So Big Island, we have some small area of more like a city. We have a sewer network. They come out with the treatment plant set up there. And the Kona has one, Hilo has one, and those are really small ones. What kind of technology they use there? This is by far is the most advanced one in this island. They do have a trickling filter plant. Remember we say 80-bit sludge plant and trickling filter plant. This one has a trickling filter. You can look at it, they have a primary treatment, secondary treatment, and then sludge management plan here. Just by aerial photo, I can see what kind of the treatment plan. And then that's the capacity. And here is the Kona site, is aerated lagoon. Okay, it's not the mechanical, it's not really high end, but it's not bad. You can have the aerated lagoon system. Certainly it looks different like this one. You have the strictly mechanical plant. This is a semi-mechanical plant. They do have a surface aerator. The rest of those plant is just a lagoon type. Okay, the one thing we talk about is the sewer. We have it in this island. We use a lot of those beyond the sewer network that houses everywhere. We use this so-called cesspool. I'm new in this island. I start learning what's a cesspool. You look at the construction for the cesspool. Basically, your gray water, your black water, just get into this tank, and they have a solid the heavy sludge settle in, the sludge settle in, and then stuff is just leaching out through those perforated the wall there. And then you can think about in this island, most we don't have a whole lot of soil, okay? And then once it leaching through there, they just go directly percolate into the groundwater. Really short detention time, we're reaching the groundwater. Then this is picture talk about, you have a cesspool there, you get into the groundwater, since it's an island, the groundwater is so close to the ocean, then just the groundwater table eventually will connect to the ocean, then the water will have this interchange along there, so they will start contaminating the stream water, the ocean water. So this is a, we'd say literally no treatment, because the idea there is that it's supposed to leaching through there, then this column has a lot of bacteria activity, you have the organic soil layer, you have some kind of plant uptake. So the better solution here is to use a safety tank here. Even this is not a high-end treatment, it's not perfect, but it's better. I just show you. The second option is to go to a one step forward called a decentralized wastewater treatment plant. I'm going to present some of the idea between those two. This is a so-called decentralized wastewater treatment plant. You have the different layer of this. You can use a nature treatment system like a wetland system, construct the wetland, mechanical plant or membrane technology. Those are different layer of the complexity and then also can say the reliability. Okay, you go to this far, you can get a lot of stuff removed, okay? But that's referred to this. And look at the safety tank, the construction of the safety tank is like this, okay? Instead of just put into cesspool like leaching, we have some kind of solid settling tank at the first stage, and then overflow to the second stage, then this provides a long enough detention time, a lot of anaerobic bacteria started working, convert this organic carbon. You have to understand anaerobic system, that means no oxygen because it's a capped tank. No oxygen, only thing can be removed is this organic carbon into the biogas. In this case, because we talk about 200, 240 and 10, really low organic carbon there, they can produce methane gas, but it's not enough to capture, to utilize. Okay, just to say, just emit it to atmosphere. But at least you can address some of the organic carbon pollution at this stage. Then you're reaching to the so-called the drainage field or leaching field. The construction for leaching field, ideally is say you have kind of clay barrier. If you don't have a clay, like this place has a lot of lava rock percolating, you probably need to put it a synthetic liner to prevent this getting to the groundwater. And the idea, put this thing in a perforated pipe, allow it to have some kind of vegetation on top to uptake the nutrient. So you talk about organic carbon removal, nutrient removal over here, sort of, not to great extent, but at least that's concept. You can get it, those pollutants can upgrade, can be removed. Remember, talk about the BOD, which is organic carbon, nutrients over here, you can remove. So in situ clay or the synthetic liner underneath the drain field to reduce the groundwater contamination and the vegetation on the topsoil for the nutrient uptake. So basically that's a concept for the safety tank. So the centralized wastewater treatment plant for the island, we have a lot of small communities, shopping mall, the new housing development or school, like I say, you have the located one place, no nearby the sewer the line, so you can just hook up those small community, provide the decentralized treatment plant. The combination for nature treatment, mechanical plant, and the membrane technology depends on what kind of the resource you have in terms of the money and the land. If you have a big land, you can go through the nature treatment process that there. So promoting the idea is nutrient recycle, effort reuse, okay? You can treat it to the level, can be irrigation table, then irrigated, and then this is a constructed wetland system. It's pretty much you have some kind of the mechanical pretreatment, get the big chunk of the solid out of here, and then go through the series of the wetland system until you remove to a certain level. Plant growth the plant root system in this kind of thing, they have a lot of bacteria there able to address the carbon removal, and the plant uptake can remove the nutrient. After a period of time, can harvesting those, the plant, that's a way called the nutrient removal, okay? And you can see it, if you go the extreme to the so-called the membrane technology, this is a membrane technology, they have really, really small footprint, high renewal efficiency, those membrane, the pore size is probably less than micron, okay, 10 to minus 6 meters. The human eye can see the dust, those are probably 10 microns. Sometimes the refraction, you can see those 10 microns. This is, micron size is less than 1, like a 0.2. So literally, all the pathogens, some of the stuff can be removed. So here is this talk about the concept, strictly use the membrane, because membrane technology is just a recent 20 years become really popular in the wastewater industry. Because they can have a really small footprint, get a really good the removal efficiency. This here is talk about everywhere you can have a membrane plant. Like you say, your hospital, somewhere you can have a specific the membrane to remove to their own set of standard there, and then address the MBR means a membrane bioreactor. Okay, you have the bacteria growing there, but when they remove it, it goes through the membrane, so it captures all the stuff there. So that's addressed to the first issue. The second issue, talk about the soil erosion and the silt runoff. This is more like a common sense here. The soil erosions can caused by the wind, water, the precipitation, and even the animal here. Those are some of the things here. So the principle, the strategy there is to reduce the water velocity or wind speed. Okay, you have to lower down the wind speed, slow down the water, the surface water the velocity, and then increase the flow retention. We don't want this, because of short island, precipitation get to land within 1 hour. If you can make that become 1 day somehow, we can show you some of the technique. Then you can allow the stuff, the silt, to settle down before it go straight shot to the ocean. That's a thing here. We talk about we talk about retention pond here. You can see divert those surface runoff into the place, allow it sitting there for 1 or 2 hours before they can overflow. That's the way you can capture your silt. There's a stormwater buffer strip. Sometimes you can build it along the highway with this. Allow the water get in here, percolate it, or stay there for a certain period of time before they can overflow it. And just slow down, you mean the retention the water. Here is the one you can even get groundwater recharge. You let this layer has some kind of filter material, and then they use this as a recharge. Because this is not wastewater, this is stormwater. It's relatively clean to begin with. So we wanted all the drinking water sources in this island, all the groundwater source, how we can recharge those groundwater, use a relatively clean the stormwater to begin with. That's the way you can do it. And here is a constructed wetland. Construct wetland, once you talk about wetland has vegetation there, they are even able to capture the nutrient. So the surface runoff from the agricultural land, like the cattle farm, they will, ideally you can use a wetland. Wetland, you can use a similar larger size, even can serve the time retention to capture the soil, remove the nutrient before they run to the stream, run to the ocean. This is a wetland system. And here is just talking about some by the goat. This is like found in the internet. In here, the goat just eat it at the surface of the vegetation, the plants, and then make this become bare to subject to the rain, that kind of thing. So this is probably replanting or wildlife management, reduce those animal count to preserve this land. And the wind barrier, that's common sense in the harvesting. After harvesting, the land subject to wind erosion, so if you build this tree as a barrier, you can slow down. The last thing you can do is use an engineering method. You cannot do everything, it's too dramatic, the slow is too much. You cannot use a natural way to preserve then we use just engineering way to preserve. And the urban solid runoff, how do you can reverse this or reduce those? You can just stone water curb, inlet screen, and the nature treatment system. So you put this preventer that get into here. Those are a lot of different way. This is a screen back. You can underneath the manhole or whatever. This is even built in a small this wetland. Allow the filter through here before you get into the stone water. So again, you have a wetland system. You have some function of remove the nutrient. So, I want to ask you as a question here, is the current wastewater regulation adequate to protect our environment?
No.
I think a lot of you answers no. I give you one clear example here, okay? That's caused a lot of problems right now. The emerging contaminant. As a population, human population getting higher and higher, so those compounds is start become concentrated, okay? And the wastewater treatment plant, you can think about that the water, wastewater, get to the wastewater treatment plant. How long they stay in wastewater treatment plant before they discharge? The answer is probably really short. You have a lagoon system, probably longer, but those modern treatment process is less than 12 hours. Sometimes it's 6 hours to 8 hours, that's typical. That treatment process, and a lot of those compounds, you look at it, synthetic, organic, antibiotic, those treatment processes, biological treatment processes, use bacteria. Antibiotic, you think that they will degrade? No way. Those synthetic organic compounds have no chance to degrade because those are synthetic. The bacteria don't even know what kind of compound there. Okay, they take a lot of time to mutate it to some of the compound can be degraded. Human on Earth each year produce probably 5,000 different new chemical compounds. How many of them has carefully studied to the environmental impact? Really few. Only the pharmaceutical company has the money to test one single drug throughout 10 years. They figure out even work or not work. That's the impact. The rest of it, sometimes it's released to the environment. They have no bacteria or the microorganism can be degraded. The wastewater treatment plant cannot degrade them, just bypass to the human estrogen. Sometimes it can be documented, those are released to the environment, they change the entire sex for the animal there, living the aquatic life, that thing here. And the industrial discharge, you can name it, that a lot of different things can be possible in there. So that's the things here. EPA right now requires to start to document that, but we have no regulation, as it probably no, we don't know how to do that, but again, I want to point out one thing. We can send a human to the outer space, right? They don't bring enough the water, right? They take a shower and eating, everything, they recycle those water. I just tell you, the technology is already ready. Anything you can do, we can reverse to the get rid of everything but water, we can purify that. That's not a problem at all, but the cost. How much are you willing to cost? Pay for to get it removed, everything. And then this is the EPA website. They document the so-called the personal pharmaceutical and the personal care product, PPCP, that tell you where they come from. And this pretty much is a chemical fate in the transport, where they end up, eventually they end up with the receiving stream, with those current technology to treat those products. A lot of us leaching. They are in the really low concentration. What's the impact? Gradually, we start to collect the evidence. They do have some impact. But think about it. What is the current standard? 30-30 standard. How long we need to wait until getting to this level? I don't know. Yeah, so just share with you. So how can you afford not doing anything at this point? I'm not tell you what's right or wrong, but this is the current status for our island here. I think that's the last slide I prepared. So, any questions?
Stay right there for questions. Thanks.
Yes.
I was wondering the cost difference between the really fine cleaning system, and like the lagoon system, you're saying it's the highest cost, it's the best, most efficient thing.
Yeah.
Kind of different.
Okay. The cost, if I make an example of the Hilo plant versus Kona plant, they are, Hilo is probably close to modern. This is in between. The lagoon system has a waste stabilization lagoon, then aerated lagoon. Here's an aerated lagoon, okay? And then you have the wetland treatment process below there, okay? But the cost, here, you can think about it, everything run by electricity. There, only has the surface aerator run by the electricity. And then here, address the sludge treatment. They have a lot of effort, probably at least 45% of sludge effort there. And the lagoon system, your sludge is after a certain year. You dredge it, you lay on flat. Here's the properly treated. So isn't the cost here is higher, and also the liability, reliable in here. Even the EPA gives a different standard. If it's a mechanical plant, you have a set of standard. Lagoon system has a set of standard in order to make sure they can survive. Okay, and here you can think about the control that suspend the solid is not easy in the lagoon system because aeration pond has those algae will grow there. Algae count as a suspended solid, right? Then how do you remove? Unless, I think they have a filtration, right? They have a filtration system, remove those suspended solid. So you're adding some that the unit process there to make sure you can meet the discharge because the Kona size is large enough to get the higher end of the treatment process. Those are lagoon systems, likely wise, give it to 500, 1,000 population community, and then use much bigger land. That's a difference there. Anything else? Yes.
What are your thoughts on getting people and their governments to do what's right and proper?
I think that the government probably is already, I think no-brainer. They probably realize, but the politics is a different story. The technology and politics is sometimes disconnect. And I think it takes, if it's an engineer or technical person, all understand this is a cost of problem, but you already give the permit for those people have a successful system, you want to totally reverse, it's not easy. You have to take it step by step, but in the new permit, I think that you should change that, because understanding the we call it geoformation for this island, a lot of pores that underneath, there's no soil there, they just straight shot there. It's not really good practice for just contaminate our drinking water source. And the drinking water, the shallow aquifer probably already contaminated, but you have some kind of deeper aquifer. Sometimes you use that the aquifer, you can date the aquifer age. Sometimes you're drinking the water is from the dinosaur age. That's possible. But you contaminate groundwater, once you contaminate, you probably stay 10 years. You try to clean it up, it takes probably 100 years to clean it up. So, yes.
Are there areas of the island where there's like high geothermal production, you know, volcanic activity, where that effluent that's coming out of the cesspool might be cooked or otherwise processed to make it a little less harmful and maybe where it wouldn't get into the groundwater? Or if it does, it's not as much.
We need to look at the geological formation, okay? The groundwater table can be shallower than the cooking action underneath. And then groundwater will migrate to the downstream. In this case, the pores probably, if it's clay, you talk about each year, probably 1 or 2 foot distance. In this, probably faster. So you know, answer your question, is it possible, but it's a really localized in the area.
You live on a rift zone, maybe right on the rift zone.
Well, yeah, I don't think it's
called Kona National Park. So.
Yeah, not a sustainable solution though. Yes.
So, correct me if I'm wrong, but 0.2 micron estrogen will still fit through that.
Yes.
So how do you remove the sex hormones from the water?
Easy, you use adipate carbon. All kind of technology, or use ultrafiltration. reverse osmosis. You're drinking the bottled water, you drink it from the Pepsi, Coca-Cola, look at the site, reverse osmosis. You can get everything out there, then they put it their mineral supplement in there. Otherwise, pure water tastes horrible. That's how they sell to you. Right. You can, the technology can do it. Ultrafield 0.2 is still large compared with the molecule. You took top of nano size. Yeah, they can still do it. Yes.
So I found Professor Sung on the website, and that's how I brought him here. I've been working on the Kelekehe wastewater problem for 18 years. But could you just explain briefly about what your holistic waste bioenergy project that you're working on at UH Hilo?
Okay, my personal research is to convert the waste to a bioderivative product, including the energy product. You look at carbon, organic carbon. Carbon is either direct or indirect from the solar energy, right? The plant fixes the carbon dioxide inorganic to organic. So organic carbon is the energy carrier. Okay, wastewater has organic carbon in there. It's subject you to how you recover those. Then there is a way, use a bacteria. Bacteria can convert a really, really low level of carbon. Okay, like you say, if you have a tree, that's a solid carbon. You can burn it, you can release the heat. But wastewater is much diluted. You have to rely on some kind of things can concentrate, uptake those diluted carbon into the cell mass. Okay, the bacteria has a really high, we call the carbon affinity. They 10 milligram per liter can support their life. They can reproduce the bacteria. They can uptake those organic carbon and convert it. In my research area, I use anaerobic bacteria. They can uptake those, convert it to methane, the biogas. You can convert the hydrogen gas. Okay, hydrogen gas, biogas, and then once the biogas is produced, you can you convert to methanol. Biogas is methane, CH4, you can CH3OH. Then I have a project right now where to convert the methane to methanol. Then give the methanol to Pacific Biodiesel. So make their production entire renewable. Methanol right now is purchased from the, I think the petroleum.
You're saying methanol, not ethanol? Methanol, not ethanol?
Methanol. Ethanol is a two carbon. Okay, one carbon is enough. Then they can make their process self-sustainable without importing methanol from the others. And then, I work on another way, it's anaerobic ammonia oxidation process. Right now, the ammonia's removal is rely on a lot of energy, the oxygen. You pump the oxygen, then oxidize ammonia to nitrite, to nitrate. This oxidation process causes a lot of oxygen. Oxygen is not highly soluble. So wastewater treatment plant put a lot of energy to a lot of oxygen dissolved in the water in order to use bacteria to work on it. Now it has a process called the anaerobic ammonia oxidation process. Ammonia oxidized to nitrogen gas. That's a -3 to 0. That's the oxidation process. Boom, get it back to atmosphere. That's a green technology. But problem for this is this kind of bacteria, they don't get a whole lot of energy gain by doing this. So their growth rate is really, really slow. The aerobic bacteria, they grow in the oxygen present condition, their yield coefficient is like a 0.6. That's how much food they can produce, how much baby bacteria. This Enamax anaerobic ammonia oxidation bacteria is a 0.03. So this subject engineer designed the robotic reactor to preserve those culture. Allow the water, wastewater go through, the bacteria stink. Otherwise, water goes through, they carry those bacteria out, you cannot get a treatment. So we are doing the immobilized cell. That's my research area to do that. Just to find some kind of the green technology in deal with environmental problem. That's my research area.
Where does the wastewater treated Kelekehe wastewater treatment plant, where do it stand? How does its concentrations compare to NPDES standards?
I believe there is also got a public, that's a national average of 200, 240 and 10. Their discharge limit, you can go to the website to look at it. I don't know
I think they have the filtration unit and the disinfection unit, right, after the lagoon system. They probably use a 30-30 standard, but I'm not sure they have ammonia level, not discharge level.
Well, they don't have to apply for MPDES permit.
They have to.
No, they don't.
They don't.
They don't. Why?
They
don't.
They have a variance.
They have a variance, yes.
Well, then where the water they discharge to?
Seepage pit.
Oh.
1.5 million gallons a day.
Seepage.
Yes.
But there are no soil that is into the groundwater.
Exactly.
Yeah. All car clean.
Oh, okay.
We have to have you come back. Check it out.
In May, Bobby Ching Lee Tech Todd, the environmental manager, is going to be giving a presentation on the current status of the $14 million repair and sludge removal. And I would like to invite you to be there, or I'll videotape it or whatever if you can't make it. But I really hope that you would look at it, study it a little bit better, and help us advise our county on our situation there.
Yeah, sludge removal, because they accumulated, because they,
yes, that's process, going to the landfill.
Their process itself do not have a sludge treatment unit. Like the modern system, they have a sludge removal unit, so they accumulate there, because it has a land, so accumulate. After a certain year, when you need to remove it, that's it.
But we would just like your input as to what sort of system would be best for that right now.
The best, you need to change everything. I think to the size, they should be able to afford a little bit more control the mechanical plant.
Yeah.
Because it's here.
We'll work on that.
That concludes our presentations today. I have a comment, one comment. I should have made this before. This speaker selection, organization, facilitation was all done by Sue Aronson. She's a great partner of mine. Thank you very much. If you would like to see this one again, we'll be having it on Naleo TV. Somebody's watching this right now saying, hey, we're watching it on Naleo TV. We'll let you know about that somewhere or another. If you want to leave a card, or you can sign up over here and leave your email address, and we'll send you that times. Also, if you'd like to see the 2015 speakers, or dynamite speakers, they were anywhere similar to this, and that is on greenhawaii.com. And you just click on that, you can see those speakers and watch that. So I know you'd be interested in that, because that's why you're here. You're interested in this type of stuff. I and everybody in this community appreciates your energy. Thank you so very much. Aloha.